We watched them surging to and fro. There was a good sprinkling of English and American tourists, easily distinguished by their expansive topees, white drill suits that made them look like something on the suburban stage, cigars, wristwatches, cameras, and incredible boots. One couple, clearly sprung from the lower middle class, probably been lucky in the war, Jeremy suggested, but not rancorously, paused near us. The woman said in a quarrelsome, disappointed tone, "It's what I told you all along, Ern. It's just like the Earl's Court exhibition, only they do have seats there." Jeremy collapsed into wordless laughter. "Don't let's look for the ape," he suggested. "He'd be pure anti-climax after that. I've found a place where you can get a God-fearing British drink." "As British as Earl's Court, I suppose. Or the British bathroom. Has it ever occurred to you, Tony, that the one real contribution of the Anglo-Saxon races towards culture is the bathroom? It's become the most important room in the house. Why do you suppose magnates like to be interviewed at unconventional hours? The number of bigwigs, beginning with Lord B.K., that I've interviewed on the bath edge would surprise you. A bathroom is now such a thing as beauty that it puts a mere drawing room in the shade. Of course, a man can't very well say, 'Cigarette, my dear fellow. Now, what about a drink? Oh, and before you go, I must just show you my bathroom.' So he stages the whole interview there. The ghosts of the ancient Romans must be getting a bit apprehensive about the way we're overhauling them. What are you doing here?" I told him. "Nice job, yours," he murmured. "Though it wouldn't suit me." "What would?" I retorted. He said contentedly, "Oh, well, I rub along all right.